And there's a hand my trusty fear, and gives a hand all thine, and will take a right good willy wacht for auld lang syne. Good morning, folks. I think it's about time we toured Scotland, don't you? Welcome to Golden VCR. Hi, everyone. Good morning. It's Wednesday, March 6th, 2024. Thank you to West Coast Deb for resubscribing at 3 months. Guess I am cool. Guess you are, Deb. Happy New Year in March. I suppose Auld Lang Syne is traditionally sung at New Year's. It's just a poem about old times in Scotland. What is your idea, Swift? Raid countermeasures. Not exact. I mean, I can infer, but no, not in a Twitch sense. What are raid countermeasures? We don't get raided very often. Are they for counteracting incoming raids? Because we do stream. Ah, okay. I see. Do you have an idea for a video? Oh. that is a classic. That is a classic video. Worth the thought. We don't, we stream content of dubious legal ownership at at 10 in the morning. So we don't get rated very much, but it's a good thing to think about. Would you like to tour Scott? Let me see if this is rewound. Hooray, it is. Kind. Oh, yeah, it's early on the West Coast, man. Mm. Well, thank you for being here so early. I guess I'm trying to think of the things I had to say this morning. I don't think I have anything to talk about. Oh! Let's see. Next Wednesday, it will most likely be the last Golden VCR stream for a bit. So, there will be no Golden VCR stream on Saturday the 16th through Wednesday the 27th. So, just a heads up on that. And if you have, tapes to mail in, don't. Because I probably won't be in the country to get them, but I will be heading. I will be heading to the post office, probably this week and right before I leave. Anyway, let's check out Scotland. Let me pull up the website. It's very. This is a project for me of doing dumb code stuff to facilitate these streams. This website is really neat. And, now I have the Stream Deck and I can just hit a button and bring the website up. But I still have to go into OBS and find the browser source and select it and click the Interact button to pop up a little window. And that's very annoying to me. I wish I had a way of doing that better. So let's see. Tapes. We want Scotland. Ooh, you can't wait to learn about Scotland. Let's learn about Scotland. This one was sent in by the Bellabunny from this attractive British Isles collection box set. We have watched Touring Ireland. You are more than welcome. What I would love to do, I would love to just deputize Dan and have him come over to my house and do these streams. And then give him whatever revenue comes in from that. But I don't know if Dan would be down for that. Okay. Touring Scotland. Visit Edinburgh, Glasgow, Aberdeen, Oban, Loch Lomond, Loch Ness, Glamis Castle, Balmoral, Culzean Castle, the Hebrides, Orkneys and Shetland, and St. Andrews. I mean, I don't own Dan. I can't just make Dan work for 4 hours a day for peanuts for me. 10 in the morning. 4 stars from Video Rating Guide, so that's more than the Brian Wilson documentary got from USA Today. Scotland is the land of bagpipes, haggis, tartans, and fabled lochs of Robert Burns, Robert the Bruce, and Bonnie Prince Charlie. Yes, that is a list of the most stereotypical Scottish things. Touring this historic, romantic, and ruggedly beautiful land, from its craggy ocean shores to its North Sea islands, from its mist-shrouded mountains to its ancient cities, this is Scotland! Embarking from the colorful borders and Hadrian's Wall, we travel to the Abbeys and to Gretna Green, to Ayr, Dumfries, and Culzean Castles, with its memories of General Eisenhower. And on to the Cinderella city of Glasgow and Loch Lomond. To Oban, Ben Nevis, Glenfinnan, and haunting Glencoe. Excursion to fabled islands, Skye, Holy Iona, and Fingal's Cave. And on to the Orkneys and the Shetlands, renowned for their lovable ponies. Search Loch Ness for Nessie. Follow the heroic tale of Bonnie Prince Charlie to Culloden. Tour the courses of the Glen Eagles. Turnberry at the Shrine of Golf. St. Andrews, something, something. Mary Queen of Scots. Holyhood Palace. Edinburgh, Gala, Festival of Music, Dance, Theater, Military, Tattoo, Edinburgh, Plaintiff's Girl, Pain and Glory. It's Scotland! Let's do it. This is from Questar Home Video, produced in 1990. Without further ado, here we go. And let me bring up the, shaboom, the, what do you call it? VCR feed. Hooray. Go. It is 9:19 p.m. in VCR land. Touring Scotland. How's everybody doing? Is anyone... Oh, no. The stand back will appear after the... Yep. Oh, you'll tack the high road, and I'll tack the low road, and I'll be in Scotland afore ye. I do think that's a beautiful song. For me and my true love wherever want to go, on the bonny, bonny banks of Loch Lomond. I have my morning coffee and a handful of wasabi peas. So I'm ready to Scott.
Each late summer night of the annual Edinburgh Festival.
Oh, thank you.
Is marked by a military tattoo. It's breathtaking. Massed regiments advancing through the gatehouse of the city's brooding castle. To drums flourishing and the skirl of the pipes. Yet some of these tartan stalwarts hail from lands oceans away from the highlands and lowlands of Bonnie Scotland. From Canada. From Australia. Among the thousands of spectators are visitors from Australia and New Zealand, nations plump with Scottish blood. And from Canada and the US, their phone directories fattened on Scottish names. And there are spectators here from places where Scottish immigrants have rarely set foot. It sometimes seems that everyone wants a swatch of tartan.
I have always wanted to go to Scotland. Were they playing the Monday Night Football theme?
And so come the visitors, not only for the stupendous Edinburgh Festival, but for the everyday, every season festival of Scotland itself.
I have distant Scottish ancestry.
One of the last great wilderness areas
being a Forsyth.
Scotland is the northernmost reach of the British Isles. With a population of over
So I've always wanted to go there.
Its land area is a bit larger than that of the Canadian province of New Brunswick, and about the size of the American state of Maine. Its southernmost point lies 1,000 miles north of the latitudes of New York. Yet the residual warmth of the Gulf Stream awash Scotland's west coast induce palms to grow and semi-tropical gardens to flourish.
I love cultural fusion ghosts.
Touring Scotland will take you to the borders, where loom the splendid abbeys built by King David I. Moody testaments to Scotland's bloodied history. The lilting landscapes of Dumfries and Ayr, stamping grounds of that most famous of Scottish poets.
I've done very basic genealogical research on my dad's side of the family, the Forsyths, and they
transformed itself.
They're like in Alabama
to the
and North Carolina, actually. Some of them emigrated from Scotland to North Carolina and then eventually made their way to Alabama. But
Bonnie banks of Loch Lomond.
You know, if you ask my grandpa or my granddaddy, my dad's dad, where his family came from, he would just tell you Alabama, North Alabama.
Where the McDonalds were treacherously murdered. Culloden's bleak moor.
But you go back, I went back in the records, and once you get to like the late 1600s, there's ancestors of mine that immigrated from Aberdeenshire.
And Harris, Inverness.
But at that point, you have like 32 or 64 great-grandparents.
According to those,
so it gets very diluted.
Over the past 1,400 years,
I could just as easily have like more ancestors from a totally different place. It's just I happen to have records.
Orkneys and Shetlands
from Aberdeenshire, and so I've always wanted to go to Aberdeen, even though I've heard it's a really depressing gray city, Aberdeen.
Castle, where tradition sets the murder of King Duncan by Macbeth. Scotland being mother and nurse of the game called golf, golfers galore come from everywhere to play the course at St. Andrews, which is 800 years old. The Firth of Forth, and all Scotland's capital, Highlands and Low, the festival city of Edinburgh. This is the Scotland of the ballad and the bonnie brae, of the wee dram and the dry wit, of the verse, the ditty, and the song, the glory and the grandeur. Human beings hugging these rugged coasts hunted and fished here some 6,000 years ago. We don't know who they were. We have no name for them.
Please tell us more about the Celts.
About 2,000 years ago, tribes that were Scotland's first historical inhabitants banded together.
Yay.
Loosely forming a nation.
Celts.
The Romans, who at the time occupied what is now England, called these tribesmen the Picts, meaning painted men, because the Picts painted themselves blue.
Leave those savages to their spiky mountains and bottomless lakes,
was the Romans' attitude. Being consummate engineers, they constructed colossal fortified walls, Hadrian's Wall, and the Antonine,
shutting out the wild men of the north. The walls still stand.
Today, yeah, I sometimes forget that it's pronounced the Boston Celtics. I call them the Celtics.
A stony symbol of the unscalable barrier separating the Scots from the English. After the Roman legions left Britannia, the Britons invaded, and the Angles. That was in the 5th century. And from Ireland, the Gaelic-speaking...
Yeah, the Doomsday Book was like William the Conqueror wanting a survey of all the lands that he now owned.
The Norse. In the 9th century, Vikings came to plunder, but stayed to settle. Scotland became a mismatch of cantankerous lowlands and unconquerable highlands. A great brawl of feuding families and petty kingdoms.
I'm so white, I'm in the Doomsday Book.
McAlpin, a united Scottish kingdom began taking shape over 1,000 years ago. And a rampant lion came to symbolize that kingdom. This is Scone Palace, original site of the Stone of Destiny. This is the place where Scotland's kings were crowned.
To 1,000 years ago, this was one of three capitals of the Scots kingdom of Dal Riada. This rock-hewn footprint and this font were sacred objects in the ancient rituals of kingship.
For centuries, the English, who to this day the Scots call Sassenachs, encroached on Scottish soil and Scottish rights. Scotland bred its defenders, William Wallace, and Robert the Bruce, who 6,000 fighting Scots whipped an English force of 20,000 here at Bannockburn.
Wasabi peas are great because they have a crunch.
And women of the north, Picts, Gaels, Celts, and Norsemen. Today, they're all Scots. Scottish, never Scotch. Scotch is the whiskey most imbibed throughout the world. Scotch describes a buttery shortbread and a game in which children hop, but never the nationality of Scotland's people. From this land, breathtaking to behold, but topped by poor soil, comes a people of confounding contradictions. Frugal, but at times generous to a fault. Excessively practical, yet romantic. Hard-nosed, yet sentimental. Dour, yet endowed with a wry sense of humor.
Dog.
Despite centuries of an austere Kirk that molded the Scots' sturdy character, Calvin...
Oh, Chaz, hello.
There's an often unresisted temptation to put faith into...
How are you, Chaz? Would you like to come in?
Indeed, touring this land, a traveler is tempted to believe in spooks himself. Scotland holds only 10% of the population of the United Kingdom, yet outstanding Scots who grace a who's who in Britain far exceed that percentage. Philosopher David Hume, James Watt, inventor of the steam engine, and opera diva Mary Garden, and Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, creator of Sherlock Holmes, and Sir Alexander Fleming, discoverer of penicillin, and on and on. The impact the Scots have made throughout the whole world is even more remarkable. From Nova Scotia, New Scotland, to British Columbia, Scots provided a large share of both the brains and brawn that built Canada. Alexander Mackenzie was born in Scotland, as was Alexander Graham Bell. 13 of the signers of the American...
Sorry, I asked Chaz if he wanted to say hi, and then Laika got very angry because Chaz is not that familiar to her yet.
So was the father of the United States Navy, John Paul Jones. And Andrew Carnegie. He was born here, in Dunfermline. Today, there is being peddled a pre-packaged stereotype of a Scotsman. Clan shops, retail tartans by the yard. The roots of a visitor's family tree can be grafted onto those of a noble Highland laird, probably named Jock. It is as foolhardy to encapsulate Scotland as kilts, haggis, and whiskey as it would be for a Scot to regard America as no more than Levi's, hot dogs, and martinis. As with folk everywhere, Scots are best seen in their mother landscape. Scotland is land, bends, crags, braes, glens. Scotland is water, burns, rivers, firths, and lochs. Scotland is place. Stand back. From its Athens of the north to its far-flung North Sea islands.
Being cold, thank you, JSpook, for the 300 bits.
It in no way imply that this region is only of borderline interest. Just follow the riverbanks to Kelso.
Scotsmen always wearing their skulls out.
Towns flanking the ancient Roman wall which thrust north from England. In the 12th century, under the great Scottish King David I, these towns saw a frenzy of church building. Four splendid abbeys arose, sealing the town's royal pedigrees. Kings were crowned here. But the borders had always been a battlefield between the Scots and the Sassenachs. Centuries of armed clashes turned them into...
Look at the dog.
Now they stand as testaments to a bloody history. To wild cheering from the townsfolk, young horsemen spur their mounts southward. Each year from towns such as Peebles and Selkirk and Galashiels, the border lads gallop to the Welcome to Scotland signs and proclaim in clarion voices the abiding freedoms of the Scots.
Oh, let me get some points out there for the people whose tapes I have put in the spreadsheet.
At the center of the borders, overlooking the River Tweed, stands Abbotsford House. Home of one of the most widely read...
Some of them are, Bella. We scanned some last stream.
Sir Walter Scott.
They're not on the website yet, but they're...
James Maxwell Scott.
I got to them.
Great-great-great-granddaughter of Sir Walter Scott, whose portrait by Sir Henry Raeburn you see here.
It's a shrine to visitors weaned on Scott's Rob Roy and Ivanhoe.
Oh, hooray! Kiwi Lee Scipio's username actually shows up now on the website. I did not change anything.
Traditionally, Scottish blacksmiths were empowered to perform weddings. And why not? Since a smith had the power to wed two metals to each other, making them one. Some centuries ago, Scotland was the place that English couples eloped to from the other side of the borders.
In accordance with ancient Scottish law, very gladly pronounce you to be husband and wife.
Dumfries and Galloway of the southern uplands, a region of hills and mountains and coastal plains. This is Robert Burns' country. Set by the waters of the Irish Sea, Killeen Castle is the showplace of Ayrshire. A medieval stronghold magnificently redesigned by Robert Adam and built in the late 1700s, it crowns a country park of 560 acres.
Oh yeah.
Today is the National Trust of Scotland, which restores and maintains.
I'm asked Chaz. He gave me $22, which you may have.
Killeen summons memories of Dwight D. Eisenhower.
Oh no, your haircut.
Supreme commander of Allied forces in World War II. In 1945.
Okay, points.
Grateful Scottish
points to Brad
Eisenhower with a spacious apartment in the castle for his use for the rest of his life. Ike, as he was called, and his family came here frequently to get away from it all.
Tapes 367.
The Ayrshire Coast harbors a golfer's dream resort, Turnberry. This windswept site was the setting for the 1986 British Open duel between Jack Nicklaus and Tom Watson. The British Open is often played here. There are two courses at
points
Turnberry.
Points to Kiwi.
And of all the great Scottish links, the Ailsa course is the most dramatic. During two world wars, a course had been leveled for use as an airfield and then faithfully restored. A gentle giant.
That's points to West Coast Deb.
17 hands high and weighing close to a ton. Originally, Clydesdales were bred for hard work. Today, they're trained for a more genteel life. Clydesdales have style.
Hill farms grace the southeastern landscape. As sacred as this soil is to the Scots, its yields in produce are sometimes small. So the farmers here have always looked to livestock as a prime source of income.
God, they sound like people.
A Hieland coo, a specimen of that shaggy native breed of Highland cattle, so at home on heaths and moors.
Greatest yield of the Scottish farms is the ploughman poet Robert Burns. Burns wrote in broad Scots dialect for plain people.
A man's a man for all that.
A lusty fellow, he wrote of his love of women.
Oh, my love is like a red, red rose.
And of his loathing of pretense and hypocrisy.
A fig for those by law protected. Liberty's a glorious feast.
Because he was their champion, he is the poet of earthy men and women the world over. His portraits appeared even on a postage stamp in Romania. A family Bible.
Is he smoking opium?
In 1759, in this cottage, to a farming family in Alloway. The first 7 years of his life were spent in these rooms.
Okay.
This is a manuscript of Holy Willie's Prayer.
Golden VCR fund points have been distributed to the following users in thanks for their contributions of tapes, which have been cataloged recently. Suntai Brad, Kiwi Lee Scipio, West Coast Deb, Haley 92, and the Bella Bunny.
In St. Michael's Churchyard. Near the old Brigadoon, bridge over the River Doon, stands a monument honoring him. In our day, people everywhere are quoting Robert Burns when they sing,
"We'll take a cup of kindness yet for auld lang syne."
River Clyde is the prime waterway to the heart of Scotland, and Glasgow is the country's biggest city, third largest in the British Isles. But from Glasgow, it's only a short excursion to Loch Lomond. There's a saying in Scotland, though Edinburgh is the capital, Glasgow is where the capital is.
Oh, it's Nessie.
Revolution through the grim years after World War
II. I love Nessie's little bat wings.
Glasgow was an urban nightmare. A smoke-choked city with the toughest neighborhoods and Britain's worst slums.
And warrens of children, their little faces painted with soot and grime. Fueled by some sound planning and the dry, irreverent wit that Glaswegians are known for, the city underwent a spectacular transformation. Today, Glasgow is the Cinderella City of Britain.
Glasgow has been university town for the past 500 years, but today, Glaswegians are calling it Culture City.
I don't know if my ghost will be accepted. It's apparently too dark.
Sir William Burrell willed his fabulous collection, which includes priceless stained glass and Chinese ceramics, to the city.
Yeah, that's what they're called, Glaswegians.
Housed in a stunningly modern museum building in Glasgow's Greenbelt.
I think it doesn't like... It doesn't want to depict children suffering, which is a fair boundary.
Ever since 1190.
Today's urchins, who've never had to scrub off the soot and grime that smudged their grandparents, submit to face painting with the Cinderella colors of the city.
A beautiful wooded valley between two lakes, the Trussocks, robber's roost for the heroic outlaw Rob Roy, who was glorified in a novel by Sir Walter Scott. It's a short trip from Glasgow.
Looking forward to it, Jace. I'll be going to the post office soon, so I'll get whatever's been delivered.
Steamer that plies the waters of Loch Katrine. The ship is well named, the Sir Walter Scott. And it's Loch Katrine that's the setting for Scott's Lady of the Lake. Even closer to Glasgow is Loch Lomond. Dubbed the Queen of the Lochs, she's set majestically in the realm of forest and mountains. Of all the lakes in Caledonia, Loch Lomond is the most celebrated in song.
I'll be in Scotland for you.
Travelers yearning to traverse the wilds of Scotland, the wild ensconced in the lap of luxury, can board the Royal Scotsman. It's the most luxurious train in the world, crisscrossing Scotland under steam haul. The six-day tour it offers is a luxury travel experience.
Train.
28 guests, yes, pampered guests, not passengers, reside on board. In the British Isles, rolling stock is called a railway carriage, not a railroad car.
I missed it. What train did he say this is?
Vintage carriage.
I've seen videos about the Caledonian sleeper.
Guardian glories.
The dining carriage, which goes between London and cities in Scotland, and it's.
It was built in 1891.
It's super bougie and nice.
Chefs are masters. Service impeccable. But the outstanding attraction viewed from these posh interiors is Scotland itself. Thrusting in all seasons into the Western Highlands, the lovely harbor town of Bolton.
Storms, 002 has won the bingo.
Glenfinnan on Loch Shiel
was one of the squares Chaz appears to say hi.
Each season in Scotland has its own special sights and sounds, its own appeal.
The 0600 hours to Mali will leave from platform 6. Calling at
steam trains.
Storms, you have been awarded points.
Glasgow make it possible to explore the Highlands comfortably in any weather. You're never far from the water. The train stops at towns and hamlets, even junctions. Somewhere the station master doubles as postmaster. Trains run every weekday, but never on the Sabbath.
I mean, we've seen a lot of people on trains, actually.
Oban's busy harbor is the finest on the Highland seaboard. It was the railway that made the town of Oban, along with the advent of steamboats.
We've watched The Christmas Train, the cartoon, if that counts. We've watched There Goes the Train, National Geographic video, Love Those Trains, Kid Songs, Cars, Boats, Trains, and Planes,
The Traveler Speaks,
World's Greatest Train Rides, Trans-Siberia, Durango and Silverton, Narrow Gauge Railroad, National Geographic, Love Those Trains.
In a winter's dawn in 1692, government soldiers of the Argyle Regiment, who had accepted the hospitality of the MacDonald clan here, brutally slaughtered every MacDonald under 70, men, women, and bairns. It is called the Glen of Weeping. It seems that the pain of this event still writhes in this brooding valley. Some 15 miles to the north is Fort William, a main base for climbers.
Oh, the one with the C.W. McCall was the Durango and Silverton.
Own Big Ben at 4,406 feet, the highest mountain in the British Isles. With winter's blasts, herds of stag migrate to the lower reaches in their search for food. Maleg is a takeoff point for a region drenched in Scottish history, its glories and its tragedies. In 1707, a union was forged between Scotland and England. England's Cross of St. George was superimposed over Scotland's Cross of St. Andrew, forming, with the old flag of Ireland, the Union Jack. To many of the Highland clans, this union was a shotgun wedding. There were years of quashed efforts to reseat a Scottish Stuart on the throne of this United Kingdom, a throne in Westminster Abbey now held by the House of Hanover.
It's a shotgun wedding.
Good-looking and tragically reckless.
If you didn't want a shotgun wedding, Scotland, you shouldn't have gotten England's daughter
Since
pregnant.
Since boyhood, he'd been called Bonnie Prince Charlie. He grew up driven by a single steely aim in life, to regain the throne for the House of Stuart. To that end, he sailed to Scotland and rallied the clans to his cause at Glenfinnan on the shores of Loch Shiel. It sparked the glorious rebellion of 1745. The showdown came on Dramwussy Moor in Culloden, where Prince Charlie's Highlanders were cut to pieces by the Duke of Cumberland's artillery. For the clans, Culloden marked the end of the Highland way of life. But Charlie escaped and lived for 42 years after Culloden. He died a broken man. The legend of Bonnie Prince Charlie looms larger in Scottish national consciousness than the man who bore that name. He's idealized in sweet pain. The sovereignty never attained. The fight well fought, but unwon. Stretching along the rugged west coast is a chain of fabled islands, the Hebrides. In fact, there are two groups of islands, the Inner Hebrides and the Outer Hebrides, often called the Western Isles. Mull, beautiful Mull, is one of the Inner Isles.
Yeah, I remember in particular the Portrait of a Great Lady, the one about the Queen Mother with David Niven, had just a ton of like, haha, they grew up and had a fun time, and oh, there's a cow in this town, and then it's like, World War II came and brought suffering, and it just jumped back and forth between that all the time.
It was to Iona that St. Columba sailed from Ireland some 1,400 years ago.
Sweet pain.
The abbey that he
that reminds me of, Haley and I last night were watching someone who's made ASMR compilations out of
Norwegian kings, as well
out of EWTN, which is the Catholic television network that's headquartered in Alabama, and they have like apparently a home shopping program where you can buy like kitschy Catholic artifacts from them. Oh, hi, Chaz.
6 miles north of Iona is tiny Staten.
Enjoy your house, Chess.
Inhabited island of bizarre rock formations. This black maw is the gaping mouth of a cave named after Fingal, a Celtic hero. Its echoes of the crashing sea inspired Felix Mendelssohn to compose one of his best-known overtures, Fingal's Cave.
Thank you for the $22, Chess. Sorry, yeah, sorry my dog barked at you. She'll get used to you. She's just not that familiar with you yet. Sky.
A big island sky, 50 miles long, shrouded in clouds of Celtic mist. It's a place of many moods and colors.
I'll give like the $22.
So irregular is this island's coast that no place is more than a few minutes from the sea. About 12,000 people live on this island. In times past, the main occupation was crofting, that is, small farming on this rocky soil. You can visit an old croft as it was then, sparse furnishings and plain. And an open Bible, printed in the Gaelic language. More than half of the island's people speak Gaelic as their everyday language. And one of the prides of Skye is its Gaelic College. Of the Outer Hebrides, Lewis holds stretches of stark moorlands, a few peat bog groves, and fewer trees. Crofting and fishing provide livelihoods. The people here were fiercely loyal to Bonnie Prince Charlie. This island loomed large in the lives of some prehistoric people, for here stands a circle of ritual stones, something like Stonehenge. No one's certain why they're here. The southerly isle is Harris. The name is found in most every wardrobe where British woolens are prized. Harris. Harris tweed. It's a cottage industry here, a traditionally hand-woven tweed of water-shedding wool. Though with today's innovative pedals to work a loom, it could be called footwoven.
This venerable lady is a last holdout. She's weaving the way the old folks did, doubly guaranteeing the qualities that have earned Harris its worldwide reputation. Her homeland, her Scotland, is much like her tweed. Coarse at times, in a home.
Sorry, I'm working on some.
But warm and comfortable.
Some code stuff to be able to do more fun alert things. And I'm already not paying attention very well, so I just figured I'd grab my laptop and see if I can get this thing working.
There's a world market for them, and supply could never meet the demand if it were otherwise. Scotland is one vast grazing ground for sheep. Even in large cities, it's often sheep that keep the turf trim on the golf courses. And in the countryside, a visitor counts many more sheep than people. There's evidence of them everywhere. Snag wool wherever you look. They even devour the morning paper. Overworked shepherds look to their dogs for help. Commanding the dogs in a complex language of whistles, flocks are moved from one pasture to another. Because of its wet, raw climate, Scottish sheep grow protective coats of remarkable depth and quality. Fleecing is a springtime ritual. Maybe it's the whirring of the power shears or the soothing hands of the shearer. But shearing mesmerizes the sheep. Inverness,
sheep just love it.
The River Ness and Loch Ness, home of the controversial monster. These are the northern highlands, stretching as far north as the road goes. John O'Groats. A chief town of the highlands is Inverness, which claims the title the Highlands' natural capital. Macbeth had a castle here once.
Dog.
For 17 years.
What does an alpaca sound like
Inverness
when it yells?
Inverness holds its highland gathering in July. But these gatherings are in vogue all over Scotland, about 100 in all, held sometime between May and mid-September.
Like a llama, yeah.
Or games are traditional.
I mean, they are llamas, right?
As the Oatmeal Olympics. Originally, the games were used for selecting bodyguards for a Highland chief.
I get most of my knowledge of what animals sound like from Ultima Online, which I played in 1998.
Warriors' belts as trophies. Today, it's silver cups.
When you had like a melee fighting character, you started out with very low skill and you had to like grind skill points to be able to hit anything. And so you would just go find a deer in the forest and like keep swinging your sword at it and missing and hitting it for like 1 point of damage. And every time you hit it, it would go, "Bah!"
Coursing through an area of,
and it took like 10 minutes to kill a deer with a katana.
Waterway from the Atlantic Ocean to the North Sea, and a triumph.
Sometimes it would get the better of you, and you'd have to run away from it, like a man with a katana, bested by a deer.
Of the natural lakes that make up much of that waterway,
ooh, Nessie penguin,
is notorious, not for the ruins of the 12th century castle Urquhart, projecting into the loch on a tongue of land, but because of the monster whose home is this cold, incredibly deep, biggest body of fresh water in Britain. Early chronicles say that St. Columba sighted the monster in the 6th century, and there have been many more sightings in the past 1,400 years. Some have been sworn to by people unlikely to fib just for the publicity. First photo ever made of what is claimed to be the monster was taken in 1933 by...
Ooh, we're getting into Jonathan Frakes conspiracy theory territory now.
Everyone's trying to get a shot of Nessie, as the monsters come to be called, with no little affection. From a TV crew from Japan to an American one-man submarine. Here's a photo made in 1972 with Nessie looking rather lumpy. Whether Nessie originates from the bottom of the loch or from the bottom of a bottle, let the visitor take heed. This monster may be a bafflement to scientists, but it's a bonanza to the local merchants. So, dear visitors, confine your doubts to whispers until you're shouting distance from Loch Ness. River Spey flows to the Moray coast, which stretches eastward from Inverness. In fishing villages named with knockabout syllables, Roseharty, Portnockey, and Banff, the family wash is drying on the clothesline. So is the family meal.
Howdy, yes, we are discovering, no, touring Scotland.
Were you to order whiskey anywhere in the world except Ireland, Canada, and the U.S., you'd be served Scotch whiskey. Perhaps that accounts for the popularity of the whiskey trail tours with some visitors. Though it's been tried, and with great expense, Scotch whiskey cannot be made outside of Scotland. The old histories claim that missionary monks were its first distillers. In 1494, it was chronicled as the Water of Life. Indeed, the soft water of the Highlands is a vital ingredient. For a Scotch to be sold legally, it must have been casked for at least 3 years. While maturing in the casks, whiskey evaporates quite a bit. Really then, all a visitor need to do is breathe in. The road north ends at Caithness, where a Dutchman named Jan de Groot once ran a ferry from the mainland to Orkney. His fine Dutch name became John O'Groats to the Scots, designating the most northerly point in Britain, 874 miles from Land's End in the extreme south of England. The archipelago of 67 islands called Orkney, meaning seal islands in Old Norse, and the 100 or so remote islands called Shetland, of which a dozen are inhabited, are the northernmost outposts of the British Isles. Travelers today don't always bother with the ferry for island hopping in Orkney. there's a scheduled airline that operates between Westry and Papa Westry, carrying school kids, pets, and the mail. It's the world's shortest commercial flight, 1 minute, 45 seconds. The Ring of Brodgar, this circle of mute stones, is a monument of a nameless people who dwelt here some 6,000 years ago. Skara Brae isn't quite so old. In 1850, a storm had uncovered a few telltale stones. This triggered an excavation. Slowly, it emerged, a Neolithic settlement 5,000 years old.
Oh, speaking of Ultima Online,
passageways, even
one of the major cities in Ultima, in the Ultima series, is named Skara Brae.
The Pompeii of Britain. Kirkwall began as a Viking trading post and grew to become a center of Nordic Christianity.
Man, what if I throw all these tapes away and just become a classic Ultima Online streamer? I don't think that would last very long.
These islands belong to Norway.
I think I'll stick with the tapes.
The 15th century. And until the end of the 1800s, Norwegian was the language spoken here. This old fishing port.
Every few years, I find a private server and go back to playing Ultima Online, and I play it for like a week, and it's
during World War II,
a huge, amazing nostalgia trip.
And sank a British battleship.
But the thing about nostalgia trips is, you know,
these barriers called the Churchill.
You can never go home again.
But these barriers weren't the only thing those Italians.
You can go back to Ultima Online, but you can't go back to being 10 years old and discovering the magic of MMOs for the very first time when the internet was a brand new thing. Oh, I played City of Heroes too for a little bit.
148 miles northeast.
You could fly. It was so cool.
Of 100 sea-worn islands.
I remember buying City of Heroes and like grinding to the point where you got to unlock the ability to fly. And the flying was like super, super slow.
Though birds are in abundance.
And then I quit. Like it was. I just wanted to be able to fly in an MMO.
As Norse rather than Scottish or British. Indeed, the nearest mainland settlement is Bergen, Norway. They're outnumbered 8-1, the Shetlanders, by sheep. Shetland has given its name to a respected breed of sheepdog, the Sheltie. As well as to a shaggy, pint-sized horse, the Shetland pony. Millions of people sat in a saddle for the first time at a Shetland pony ride in a park. Aberdeen and Dundee, the two major cities of eastern Scotland, are only 70 miles apart. In the backyards between them, there's a lifetime of vistas. Then, a short jaunt to Fife, the holy land of golf. Who has not heard of the granite city, Aberdeen? Granite in the glistening stone the city's built of, such as Marischal College, where the sparkling stone has been made to resemble lace. Granite in the flinty character of its people. Aberdeen exudes self-assurance and prosperity. It's the capital of Scotland's fishing industry. At the crack of dawn, fish brokers, wholesalers, buyers, and merchants, all charged with a new day's energy, are bartering in a language understood only by those in the trade. They're a shrewd lot, but then, so are the gulls.
Put mackerel in seagull mouth.
Early morning might find a chopper taking off from Aberdeen, a city which had easily assumed the role of the oil capital of Europe. Destination.
I love the VHS director chair in the background.
Platform 703 is a drilling rig. 200 lives are at stake here. Back when, it was assumed that the impact of the North Sea oil discovery would cure all of Scotland's economic ills. It hasn't. In the meantime, some must be content to count their blessings in barrels. Taking its name from this spine of mountains, Grampian is Scotland's northeastern shoulder. An unusually high number of royal warrants are displayed by the tradesmen of this village. That means that they're supplying goods or services to the royal family. It's no wonder. Balmoral Castle is nearby.
I think Queen Victoria we all know Balmoral now because it's where Queen Elizabeth II died, right?
So her devoted husband and consort, Prince
That's the only thing built her this I know about it as an American.
Scottish baronial style. Balmoral. But it's the 13th century Blair Castle that smacks genuinely of feudal Scotland. This whited stronghold is the home of the Duke of Atholl, the only citizen in Britain with the right to maintain a private army, the Atholl Highlanders. Tayside gushes with cataracts and rushing streams, chilling the boots of fly fishing sportsmen, before emptying into Loch Tay, which has the source of River Tay at its foot. In long, neat rows in the Tayside valleys, raspberries are grown for the jam factories of Dundee. Dundee is Tayside's big town, known for its jams and marmalades.
I like the Sims 1 music.
There's more to Dundee than preserves. There's preservation. Victoria Dock harbors the RRS Discovery, which carried Captain Robert Scott's 1901 expedition to the Antarctic.
Freshwater pearls from River Tay have been treasured for centuries. They grace the crown jewels of Scotland, of England. They've been recovered from the ruins of ancient Rome. This Tayside pearl fisher searches patiently for his pearl of great price.
The equipment is all you need is a forked stick and a glass-bottomed bucket and a sack to put the shells in and a good pair of waders. That's your equipment. That's your technology. Now, here's a shell here that it's twisted. There's a pearl in this one you know before you open it. There you are. There's a good pearl in this one. Lift it out with your fingers and put it in your mouth and put it under your tongue. That's the safest place to keep them.
Glom's Castle, with its crenellated battlements, dates mainly to the 17th century. But there was a castle here 1,000 years before that. Shakespeare had made this site the setting for Macbeth.
Of Glom's.
Home to the Earls of Strathmore, it's as close to a fairy tale castle as any in Scotland. It was at Glom's that Princess Margaret was born. Her mother, now the Queen Mother, was Lady Elizabeth Bowes Lyon of the House of Strathmore.
What a great lady.
The man she'd marry was the Duke of York, who, because of his older brother's abdication, would become King George VI. But they were a giant step from the throne when this snapshot was taken. She had no notion then that her firstborn, Elizabeth, would one day be queen. This is the present Lady Strathmore, seated in the wing reserved for the Queen Mother's visits.
Hello. I'm Mary, Countess of Strathmore, and I would like to welcome you very warmly indeed to Glom's Castle. Glom's is steeped in history and has very many beautiful rooms, but I am now sitting in one of my very favorite rooms, which is known as the Queen Mother's sitting room.
There's a sort of castle, a Scottish palace in the glens, where everyone is treated like royalty. The Glen Eagles Hotel stands tall in the Perthshire landscape. An all-round sports resort, its moorland courses are regarded as a golfer's dream. The hotel itself offers the kind of pampering that a true sportsman shouldn't need, but likes.
I don't know if Ghost of Glan's, Deb, is going to work.
Bought separately,
I would say that might get rejected.
5 pounds, and that's just the weight gain.
That may not be, I don't know if there's a charitable interpretation.
Jauntily into the North Sea, its coastline notched with picturesque harbors, ending at the fishing village of Crail. Crail's become something of a holiday.
How strange. I think it's Glamis Castle.
But Fife's history centers in St. Andrews, once a cathedral town and the seat of Scotland's oldest university. Today, St. Andrews is a shrine, not for its religious significance, but for the cult of the green turf. Serious golfers are drawn to St. Andrews like pilgrims. Here, the old course, laid out in the 15th century, the highest place among the courses of the world.
Golf.
The Royal and Ancient Golf Club, formed in 1754, is the world's guardian of the rules of the game. St. Andrew's course is a links, a sandy, undulating piece of land bordering the seashore. It's the...
Wait, what?
Scottish course.
Wait, what? What?
Passing from Fife through the first...
No, we're going to turn that off. What? Why would it do that?
To our starting point.
Why would it do...
City of Edinburgh.
It's not supposed to do that.
Firth is a word the Scots use for a long,
Jesus,
narrow inlet from the sea. And here is...
What? I do not understand the moderation filter on this.
The Firth of Forth. Bridge, begun in 1883, is a marvel of 19...
Well, anyway, don't worry about it.
Opened in 1964. This is a gateway to Edinburgh.
Really did not expect that to go through.
To where it all started. Majestic Edinburgh.
It's like
the true capital of Scotland in the heart.
You know, it's so restrictive and has so many filters in place that, like,
100 years since the first settlers arrived on this,
you're supposed to not have to do any filtering.
Centuries. A fortified town arose, stretching from Castle Rock to the...
Ooh, oh boy. Oh boy.
That was the thimble size of Edinburgh when a striking young widow arrived here some 400 years ago. Mary Stuart, Queen of the Scots. Almost 6 feet tall and every inch of her a queen.
Mary was brought into the world.
Please don't report me.
1542, here at the palace at Linlithgow. Her royal father, King James V, lay dying here in Falkland Palace, praying for a son. When he learned it was not a boy.
My Majesty came with a light.
Yeah. Yeah. They were standing back. They were asleep. Thank you for the 300 bits tech capsule.
Mary was hardly a year old.
Oof.
When at Stirling Castle she was crowned queen. She grew up romping in this garden.
The only reason I submitted that was because it was an obvious thing that was going to get blocked, and we were making a point about how it blocks things. Ugh.
When she was 15, she was married in Paris to the Dauphin of France, who was a year younger. They grew fond of each other. And when her young husband died 2 years later, Mary wrote, "By day, by night, I think of him. My heart keeps watch for one who's gone." Returning to Scotland, she began her reign honestly and fearlessly. Her tolerance was unique among the rulers of her time. A Catholic herself, Mary dealt fairly and without bigotry toward subjects of different religions. A royal Stuart, Lord Darnley, became her second husband, and Mary reigned from Holyrood through 6 years of affronts to her power. She had been pregnant for 6 months when in this room, in front of her eyes, her secretary, David Rizzio, was murdered in cold blood. So that the shock would kill both queen and heir in premature childbirth is what many believed. If that was true, the plot failed.
Hi, Trill.
In this chamber in Edinburgh Castle, Mary did give birth to a son. The child lived, so did the mother. He was christened James. Now, Lord Darnley, her child's weak, conniving father, was strangled by those conspiring against her.
It's gonna get
Mary
dark
found herself, a woman alone in a lair of power-hungry nobles. Despite her marriage to the Earl of Bothwell, at their urging, her nobles imprisoned her in Lochleven Castle, where she was pressured into signing away her crown in favor of her infant son. The dauntless queen engineered an escape from
Lochleven. We'll try not to get banned.
For England to plead with her cousin, Queen Elizabeth, for help.
I might have to go ahead and censor that in the VOD, just so
she sailed from this shore.
No evidence remains on any anyone else's platforms. Queen to queen.
Rather, she imprisoned Mary for the next 19 years.
Well, I don't know if you're allowed to ban me, Bella.
Condemned to death for conspiring against her person. I have not procured nor encouraged any hurt against Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth. When Elizabeth signed Mary's death warrant, she was already 53 years old, an increasingly homely woman under her flaming red wigs, and she was barren. Mary of Scotland had always loved animals, particularly dogs. When she marched so bravely, so calmly to the block, her pet terrier was seen peering from under the skirts of her gown. She stretched herself at length, laid her neck on the block, commending herself to God. It took the axeman 3 horrid strokes.
It's gonna get dark soon.
One of Mary of Scotland's mottos was prophetic. In my end is my beginning. Elizabeth died childless. It was Mary's son, James the 6th of Scotland, who succeeded to the English throne as James the 1st of England. The first of the House of Stuart, whose bloodline infuses Britain's royal family of today.
It's here at Holyrood that direct descendant of Mary's resides when she's in Edinburgh, the sovereign of the United Kingdom. Her Majesty enters the forecourt of Holyrood to receive the key to Edinburgh from the Lord Provost. Mary, Queen of Scots, had hoped earnestly that Scotland and England might be ruled from the same throne. Today, that hope is realized in Queen Elizabeth, the first Queen Elizabeth of Scotland.
Oh yeah, Scotland got their own in Parliament in
the second of England.
What, the mid to late 90s? But it,
her roots draw deeply from the Scottish past.
They still have not voted to.
She belongs to Scotland every bit as much as she belongs to England.
Voted for independence.
The spine of the ancient city. Running from Holyrood House to Edinburgh Castle is a stretch of road that packs the scope of Scottish history into 1 royal mile. Two 200 years ago, a bet was made by a pair of old Edinburgh golfers. Who would be the first to drive a ball over the crown steeple of St. Giles, the mother church of the Church of Scotland? Perhaps the ball struck the nearby statue of John Knox, Scotland's religious reformer, who'd cast a jaundiced eye on golf. At the west end of the Royal Mile, the towers and turrets of Edinburgh Castle, perched on an outcrop of volcanic rock. A hallowed stronghold that throughout the centuries grew to become a sprawling complex of batteries and barracks, palaces and prisons. it is still a working castle and headquarters for the Scottish Division of Her Majesty's Army. If there is a national shrine in Scotland, it is this castle.
Ding dong, the witch is dead.
The Scottish crown jewel.
Yeah, lots of people seem to really hate Margaret Thatcher.
The date to 1306. The sword and scepter were gifts.
It seems like she did a lot of very lasting damage to the social safety net of the UK.
Royal regalia in Europe. The lake that once lapped at Castle Rock.
Oh yeah, they were buds.
Providing a fertile soil bed.
They were partners in crime.
The most spacious and elegant park in Scotland. Bordering the gardens is Princes Street itself, a splendid mile-long boulevard for shopping and promenading, landmarked by this spiky monument to Sir Walter Scott, nicknamed the Gothic Rocket. Old Edinburgh had been a walled-in city, so it had to build up like a medieval Manhattan. The expanding city had to escape its walls. So the city stretched over the valley, and in a green field, the building of Newtown began. Built between 1766 and 1840, Newtown is a model of urban planning. Shaded squares and elegant streets and crescents lined by splendid Georgian houses. Alexander Graham Bell was born at Charlotte Place, and Robert Louis Stevenson lived at Harriet Row. The outburst of creativity that built Newtown launched the Scottish Enlightenment. The arts flourished, and the sciences. Edinburgh glowed in its international reputation as the Athens of the North.
He's so cute.
Fame was earned.
I love his golf ball
medical school
head.
The plots of medicinal herbs cultivated for study grew to become the city's vast botanical garden. Indeed, the city's renowned for the giants of medicine it has produced.
Another botanically related medical breakthrough was Alexander Fleming's discovery of penicillin. And over here, one November evening in 1847, a young Edinburgh professor caused his guests to fall unconscious under the dining room table there, because this was the home of James Simpson, the pioneer of chloroform and the deep sleep of anesthesia.
This is proud Edinburgh, of which Robert Louis Stevenson, a native son, wrote,
"This profusion of eccentricities, this dream of masonry and living rock is not a dropsy, but a city in the world of everyday reality."
Yeah, I figured it wasn't going to get a style that specific, but you never know.
But like Stevenson's Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, this city has a murky alternate personality. This was particularly evident in the last century. It was then that two seemingly respectable fellows, William Burke and William Hare, stalked the gloomy wynds and closes in search of victims, unsuspecting citizens, to strangle. They then sell their corpses to the medical schools for a pretty penny.
It's gonna get dark soon.
In our waning century, Edinburgh after dark is more frolicsome than fearsome.
You can now get strangled at the music club.
There are elegant pubs for a wee dram, and restaurants glowing with tradition. And for brave visitors, the rugged national dish, haggis, a mince of entrails, oatmeal, and poetry.
Try and shed your gushed entrails brecht like ony dish. Then, oh, what a wondrous sect!
That's right, you have to read a Robert Burns poem to the haggis.
Haggis!
Once initiated to the haggis, visitors are regaled by old Scotland.
Scotch eggs are delicious. I've never made them because they seem like a pain.
We'll be right back.
it's the frying and having to like make, you know, make the meat and the making the meat at the right consistency, and then you have to bread the thing. You gotta like envelop the egg properly in a solid meat orb.
Theater troops, opera companies, dance.
I'm sure it's not that bad. Like, I've seen videos on how to do it.
Church hall and makeshift theater.
But yeah, it's a lot of mess.
Of the central city. And when this night tilts into tomorrow, the batteries of floodlights are dimmed out, leaving a single shaft on a solitary piper on the battlements. Somehow, heard in the pipe's plaintive skirl is Scotland, its pain and heroism and glory. Scotland, the bonnie. Scotland, the brave.
Touring, Scotland. Executive producer, Albert Nader. Brought to mind, should old acquaintance be forgot and auld lang syne. For all... Ba, ba, ba. Happy Scotland! Lang syne, my dear, for all lang syne. We'll take a cup of kindness yet for all lang syne. I never would have thought... Sorry, I should be reflecting on Scotland. But I never would have thought, you know, in the olden days, you did very basic rudimentary filtering to try and like root out a bad content. Like, for example, you would just have code that's like, does the word penis appear in this? If so, don't do it. Nowadays, we have these fancy AI models that are supposed to be able to like interpret the meaning of words and be able to detect whether it's objectionable. So, you know, I thought, gee, there's no need to have like any special case code that's just like if penis, no. But the stupid AI can't like tell that there's gonna be a penis in there. If penis, no. Not on stream, thank you. Anyway, that aside, we have toured Scotland. Yeah, there's so many stupid things that it's like, nope, can't do that. And then it will just do penis castle. What should we watch? That was 69 minutes, actually, of touring Scotland. What are we doing next? Do y'all want more long thing, or should we do short thing? Psychopike. Oh, man. Should we do Prayer Bear to atone for our sins? How long is Psycho Pike again? Yeah, I think Psycho Pike should be a weekend. I think that's a good point. Book of Virtues? Hell yeah, we could do Book of Virtues. Thank you, Trill. Donut Man at the Zoo. Okay, Virtues. Which Virtue? These all appear to be from the same year, and they're all roughly the same amount of favorited. Can we get a poll for Courage, Compassion, Honesty, and Work? Shall I make the poll? I can make the poll. Poll. Virtue. Courage. Compassion. Honesty. Work. 1 minute. Start poll. What's your favorite virtue? Speaking again of Ultima. These aren't the right virtues. Honesty, compassion, valor, justice, sacrifice, honor, spirituality, and humility. So let's see. Work has camel. It's how the camel got his hump and other great stories. Is this a Tom Sawyer? So that's camel. There are seconds left in the poll. Get your votes in. Courage, which looks like the one it's going to be unless the vote changes now. Oh, work pulled ahead. Work wins. All right. Well, courage is William Tell shooting his friend in the head with a crossbow for some reason. I don't know why they decided to do that. I guess we'll have to learn that another time. Cool. Well, these were sent in by Slick Duke. I know some people recognize the series, apparently. When I put these on the shelf, Haley came down and was like, oh my god, these tapes. So, I guess they were somewhat popular back in the day. In certain circles. Let me go find Adventures from the Book of Virtues. Work. Ooh, look at that. Look at that camel. Look at its pixel legs. All right, be right back with the tape. Do this in remembrance of the Buttercream Gang. You know, I bet, what do you bet, Penis Castle was okay, but cigarettes is not okay. Oh, here we go. It worked. Oh, God. Oh, no. Why is he in a robe? I think maybe large lump of camel flesh was okay too. Okay. A Dark Souls camel. All right. Well, anyway, here's another camel. It's Adventures from the Book of Virtues. Work, How the Camel Got His Hump, and other great stories. Let's see. This tape is from 1996, from Porchlight Entertainment, distributed by PBS Home Video and Turner Home Entertainment. 30 minutes. When a raging storm wrecks Plato's Peak, Sock the Bobcat learns it's all in the attitude as he grows to understand the value of a hard day's work. Showing no initial interest in helping his friends clear the storm's debris from the rain bowl, Sock is soon enlightened about the fruits of labor. There's a lot of scare quotes in here. While reflecting on how the camel got its hump, English/Scandinavian, the message of cooperation in The Bundle of Sticks, Greek, and Tom's unusual work ethic in Tom Sawyer Gives Up the Brush, American. Let's do it. This tape is rewound. Kind. Let's... Oh, we've been rewinding touring Scotland. Let's do it. Let's work. Let's learn about the joys of work with Adventures from the Book of Virtues. I want a dedicated tape that's Adventures from the Book of Virtue about the virtue of rewinding VHS tapes. You have to rewind them. How could you not rewind? What's that? A logo. It must be captured. It is my mission.
The following presentation is from...
What's this? Another logo that needs to be recorded as a separate video file so that they're easier to catalog and edit.
The following presentation is from PBS Home Video.
The Reader's Digest intro is so cool. It's cooler than it has any right to be. I do not associate Reader's Digest with cool. But boy.
When a big storm hits Plato's Peak, everyone pitches in.
I'm probably up to like 30 minutes worth of logos.
You don't need me to get the job done.
I will have to make a supercut at one point.
Story about, and we see how Tom Sawyer handled the job in front of him. Join Plato.
I didn't like that sound effect.
Annie and all their friends. Coming up next on Adventures from...
Oh yeah, Zach. It's got Zach... and Annie, like they're the featured protagonists of the series.
More about Adventures from the Book of Virtues. Visit our website at PBS Online.
Pre-HTTPS
Adventures
URLs.
From the Book of Virtues is made possible by a generous grant from.
At Cigna, we're a business of caring, and because we care about families, we're proud to sponsor Adventures from the Book of Virtues, Cigna, a business of caring.
And by the Arthur Vining Davis Foundations. Additional funding provided by the John M. Olin Foundation.
In the Tom Sawyer sketch. No word. Am I glad that's done? Their names held on screen. Ooh, hold on. That's a logo. It's been a while since we've had so many good logo graphics in one tape.
Adventures.
Hey, 1,000 bits from Jace Book. Let's do it.
Adventures from the Book of Virtues was made possible by a generous grant from...
At Cigna, we're a business of caring. And because we care about families, we're proud to sponsor...
Hey, good luck, Amaya. Glad the car odyssey is coming to an end.
Cigna, a business of caring.
And by the Arthur Vining Davis Foundations. Additional funding provided by the John M. Olin Foundation.
Oh yeah. All right. That was Adventures from the Book of Virtue work. And this is Song of the Sun, a Brazilian drum set, courtesy of Jace Book. Thank you to Jace Book for the 1,000 bits. Here are some good beats to listen to while working. And you'd better be working. Song of a Sun from Brazilian Coordination for Drum Set. What are we going to watch next? I think I might do a random. I think we've had some good picks so far, but I think we should do something random. And we can do our, if it's something that doesn't look good, we can do our old standby. The 10 minute. Mystery tapes tend to be really long, so I don't want to launch into one of those right away. Like in the middle of a, when we're already 2 hours in. Zelda Master cheered 1,050 bits. Thank you for Don't Touch Me. Give me steam! Give me steam! Thank you so much. I would love to hear Don't Touch Me again. I got to get these on the website, on the list. It's a very rudimentary page that just lists the songs we have, and I need to get Don't Touch Me on there. I need to get Unpig in the Pond and We've Got Cake. More Bells and Whistles, if you remember, was a standout from the Computer Animation Festival tape. Oh, excellent, Deb. You're going to love Don't Touch Me. You're all going to love it. Hey, a 4 month resub from Storms 002. 4 months, woo. Woo indeed, thank you. As a reminder, folks, please, 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 if you are a subscriber, send in those resub messages. That is what gets you 600 Golden VCR fund points. Hey, meeting done. 4 month resub from Lost Vagabond. Points, points indeed. Enjoy them. Let's go check out. Oh, the exuberance of not being in a meeting anymore. It's beautiful. All right, I have to find, because I have not yet gotten an exact edit nailed down of Don't Touch Me and put it in the right place, but we've got it here. Don't Touch Me. You're really going to love it. All of you. Every single one of you. Even those of you who saw it before and hated it. You're going to love it this time. Thank you to Zelda Master for this one. Hey, thank you for fueling the steam train. Don't touch me with your love. This was very early and rudimentary mocap. This character was billed as the world's first virtual performer. Collapsing in exquisite pain. I love the way her arms clip through her chest. There's absolutely no, like, solving in this character egg whatsoever that had not been invented yet. You can see her feet, like, sliding around the floor because there's no actual, like, foot IK or anything. We've gotten this hype train to level 3, everybody. Thank you. I think that's a first. I don't know, but appreciate your support. All right, it just fades out. Well, that was Don't Touch Me. Don't Touch Me, indeed. Don't do it. I really think that's on par with Peter Gabriel's Steam, to be honest with you. It's a cultural artifact of great significance. Okay, tell you what I'm going to do. Oh yeah, it's J-Spook's Kryptonite. We discovered. Everybody has one thing that they do not want to come back to. Okay, we're going to do a random tape. Hey, 3 month reef sub from Rebel Tech TV. Thank you. I think we should do a random tape. First, though, because I would like to run ads for just a second to disable pre-rolls so that it will give me a chance to capture... Whoops. Wait. Oh, I took the tape out. It'll give me a chance to grab the intro song from Book of Virtues, just in case. Just in case we need it later. Stand back. Coming up next, all right, I'm running ads. Adventures from the Book of Virtues. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
To meet some of our characters and learn more about Adventures from the Book of Virtues, visit our website at PBS Online. Adventures from the Book of Virtue.
Oh, enough with the weird ad. Come on.
A Business of Caring.
And by the Arthur Vining Davis Foundations. Additional funding.
All right, here we go. We love a good... But we have, let's see. We have several more of those. That tape and others like it, by the way, was sent in by the Slick Duke. Thank you to the Slick Duke. We also have Courage, Compassion, and Honesty, which we can watch some of the time. Do you know which one you had, Haley? And is it still in your parents' house? Haley, did you see Penis Castle? I don't think you were here for it. But anyway, we had an incident, but we recovered. Yeah. Oh, no, that's great. That's great. You're doing good. Don't clip it. Actually, don't clip it. I hope no one clipped it. If you clip something. So here's the thing. I upload the VODs to YouTube, so there is a record on YouTube's platform of what's going on here. And if they don't like what's going on here, then they might do something about that. Twitch, these streams are not archived. So if they don't like what's going on here live, that still might be an issue. But if they don't, but if it's like they can't retroactively, anyway, if you clip something, it creates evidence on Twitch's platform that Penis Castle exists. Thank you, James E.P. I appreciate your foresight. Oh, geez. Whew. Anyway, hey, how about we do a random tape? I have no filters in here. It could be fitness. It could be mystery. Who knows? Random. Nature's Assassin Supreme Killers. That, no. You can sign American Sign Language for Beginners. That's 82 minutes of sign language instruction. Sorry, Snake Tape. There's already enough in this VOD that might need to be altered or removed. And the last time we did Nature's Killers, it had a copyright thing and had to be removed. Christmas, no. Psycho Pike, we're saving that for Saturday. Belly Dance. Beverly Hillbillies, copyright. Choosing Quality Child. Let's do Choosing Quality Child Care. That seems fine. ASL would be fun, yeah. There's one in particular that we want Haley to be here for, like on camera for. And we don't have the setup to do that yet. Choosing Quality Child Care. I've been wanting to watch this one because it's from the Oklahoma Department of Health and Human Services. And that seems like it might be something. Be right back with that. Unkind. Ooh, I would love ATC tape. That sounds fun. This needs to be rewound in the VCR. Or the rewinder does not like it. Also, Haley, what do you mean I attempted to sign? I did sign. Haley and I went to a restaurant, and the people at the
Department of Human Services.
The people at the table next to us. The people at the table next to us were being very loud, and I wanted to remark on it to Haley without being, you know, rude. So I was just like, "It's very loud in here. They're being very loud." I think I got the point across. We are rewinding Choosing Quality Child Care. Let's take a peek at it. State of Oklahoma, Department of Human Services, Sequoia Memorial Office Building, Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. Dear parent, as a parent, one of the many dilemmas of parenthood is choosing a child care program that meets your child's needs. The Department of Human Services Office of Child Care is providing you with a 10-minute videotape. Oh, it's only 10 minutes. Great. Choosing Quality Child Care and a parent brochure. The ABCs of quality child care. We hope this information will assist and support you as you make this decision. The Office of Child Care believes the selection of your child care arrangements to be one of the most important decisions you will make for your child. For further information or assistance, please contact the Office of Child Care at 405-521-3561 or 800-347-2276. Sincerely, Prinz Ella Anderson, Programs Administrator, Office of Child Care. The distribution of this video is made possible through the Child Care and Development Block Grant funding. And this has been duplicated by Vaughn Communications Incorporated through the University of Oklahoma. Copyright 1996. Let's do it. It's time to choose some quality child care. Reset the counter. And go.
Today, more than half of all mothers return to work before their baby's first birthday.
Hi, Fran.
Child care is a way of life for most families. Choosing good child care may be one of the most important decisions you'll ever make. After all, children are in daycare more than adults are at work. They arrive earlier and they stay later. Parents need to understand that daycare has a really important impact on their children's lives. Fortunately, we know that children can blossom and grow in a good child care program with caring adults.
I like her accent. It sounds very Oklahoma. This is a Oklahoma Journalism Hall of Fame.
I know it's
article about Fran Morris.
To work, and she goes to the daycare, and I know her needs are being met there. I don't have to worry about her when I'm at work and she's there, and it's a good quality center. I mean, her needs are being met, and she likes the toys, and she likes the children there, and she's learning to get along with everybody. And I know it's the right thing to do, and I just feel proud of both of us when I go and I leave her. So.
Parents should look carefully for a program where their child can be both happy and safe. This video will help you know what to look for in choosing the best care available for your child. There are two types of child care settings for you to consider: home-based care and care in larger centers. Daycare centers may be small and located in a home setting, or they may have much larger numbers of children. Any good child care program welcomes a visit from parents, so plan to take a good look before you leave your child there.
We want parents to be concerned and involved in their child's care. We encourage them to visit with other parents, to visit with our teachers, to look around, make themselves comfortable. We're proud of the care we provide here, and we want parents to always feel welcome.
Make unscheduled visits to more than one program before you decide. It takes time to make a good decision, but you'll be glad you did.
Unscheduled visits makes a lot of sense.
Every part of the center or home where your child will be spending time, including the playground, bathrooms, and rest areas. When you visit, you should have several things in mind to look for. For example, play areas should be bright and cheerful. Is there a good supply of toys that are easy for children to reach? Toys and games should be colorful, creative, and appropriate for that age group.
Oh, the kitchen.
And rooms should be kept at a comfortable temperature.
The play kitchen.
Observe the caregiver. The adults who care for children are the most important factor in quality child care. Find out which teacher will work with your child. Spend some time watching how she relates to children and how they respond to her. Is she patient and warm with a good sense of humor? Does she call children by name and speak to them at their eye level? Is she gentle and encouraging, but firm? Learn how discipline is handled. Parents should be sure that the caregiver's methods are acceptable to them. Watch the children. The attitude of the children is a good indicator of the atmosphere of the program. Are children happy, relaxed, and comfortable with the staff and with each other? Is this a place where your child would be happy? What about supervision? Are there enough staff to meet the needs of each child? The younger the child, the more caregivers are needed. And children should never be left unattended.
What is this?
Check out the daily activities. Good caregivers help children learn as they play. There should be a balanced program of activities that are planned in advance. Activities should be geared to each group's age level. While infants need to be cuddled and rocked and talked to,
little blob child,
school-age children should have more relaxed and recreational play. Storytelling, sharing time in a group, art activities, music time, and daily outdoor play should be familiar parts of the schedule.
This seems like a quintessentially Oklahoman activity.
Especially for
Playing in oil barrels.
Look,
sleeping on prison cots.
The facility should provide a safe and hazard-free setting for children.
The image of safety.
Play equipment should be sturdy and in good condition. There should not be any hazards or dangerous items where children can reach them. Medicines and cleaning fluids should be stored out of reach or kept locked. Restrooms should be clean and easy to use with individual or paper towels and sturdy step stools as needed.
I love the labeled diagram that it made for no reason.
Growing children need good food. Check the planned menu for the week. Are the meals balanced and nourishing? Meals should include meat or protein, a vegetable and fruit, bread and milk. Are there second helpings available? Are they foods that you want your child to have? Children should also be served a morning and an afternoon snack. And finally, look for the state license.
Hey, I've never eaten a corn dog that didn't nourish me.
All daycare centers and family daycare homes be licensed. Licensing representatives make unannounced visits to child care providers to offer consultation and to make sure that providers are meeting the requirements. Although a license does not guarantee quality, it does ensure that a trained professional is checking the program. If you have a concern that cannot be handled by talking to the director or family daycare home provider, you may wish to contact the licensing representative. They will investigate complaints that licensing requirements are not being met. Check with the local Department of Human Services office to obtain the telephone number. In addition, licensing representatives can tell you about child care in your area and assist you in considering this important decision. You may also wish to look at the case records for each licensed facility. These cases include the record of visits and complaints that have been received. Your interest and involvement are so important during the years your child is in daycare. Take time to talk to the caregiver about your child's progress and emotional
well-being. There we go.
Well-being.
There's our blob boy.
And talk to your child.
He's
about
so precious,
his or her
sleeping in the graveyard.
When I leave and go to work, I don't want to have to worry whether my child is happy and safe and being well cared for. I want to know that he is with people who provide quality child care for him and that he's in a safe environment.
Good script
Parents
read.
Parents and caregivers should work together as partners to ensure that each child's individual needs are met so that he or she can thrive and feel successful. We hope this will help you make the very best decision for your child's care. All these suggestions are contained in two publications that are available free of charge through the Department of Human Services. Thanks for taking the time to learn more about choosing good child care. We can all benefit from having today's children develop in safe, caring, appropriate environments.
Hey! This was a great resource for parents in Oklahoma. This is the kind of public outreach, like, hey, here's how to make sure your kids don't get, like, abused. Here are the resources that are available to you. Here's the things you should look for. Here's the office you can call if you want to get information to research these things. It's all great stuff. All great stuff. Yeah, that was eight and a half minutes long. And I like the state of public services and funding for public services in this country is such that we don't, our state governments and agencies don't even like get grants to produce VHS tapes anymore. And I think that's a shame. Alrighty. Y'all want to do another random one? Let's do another random one. Let's see what we pull. Huh! Drag Racing 1993 from Diamond P Sports. This one was sent in by Good Fortune Coffee. It looks very long. It's a lot of drag racing footage. But we're going to put it in the VCR and we're going to see where it goes. If we don't like it, we can hit the bricks. Hey, I think the tape is gonna drag, all right. This is Drag Racing 1993 from Diamond P Sports. Top Fuel, Pro Stock, Funny Car. Wait, what? I'm sorry. Top Fuel, Pro Stock, Funny Car, Pro Stock Bike. Funny Car. Woo, all right. Sure. Funny Car. Drag Racing 1993. The 1993 NHRA drag racing season was one of terrific excitement, tough competition, perilous moments, and many questions. Would the oldest driver on the circuit take a new car and conquer the top fuel class? With the 1991 Funny Car champ reclaim the crown in his 93 comeback tour? Apparently, Funny Car is a like official contest of the drag racing scene. Could the reigning Pro Stock and Pro Stock Bike champs defend their titles? All the answers are here in Drag Racing 1993, Diamond P Sports annual review of the complete NHRA national event season, including all the dynamic action from Top Fuel, Funny Car, Pro Stock, and for the first time, Pro Stock Bike. You'll follow the Top Fuel War as Eddie Hill looks for his first NHRA title in a long career. But Kenny Bernstein and five-time champ Joe Amato are on his heels. Meanwhile, John Force is on a mission to reclaim the Funny Car title he lost in 1992 to Cruz Pedregon. Can anyone slow him down? Warren Johnson looks to defend his Pro Stock crown from his own son Kurt and former protege Scott Jeffrion. And in Pro Stock Bike, John Myers wants a third title for his mantle, but hard-charging Dave Schultz has something to say about it. Every significant moment from this incredible season is here. Thrilling competition, danger, and ultimate victory for the NHRA champions. And you can follow all the stories in Drag Racing 1993 from Diamond P Sports, St. Petersburg, Florida.
Well, it's gonna get
1993. I really want to learn about Funny Car. Oh, shit. I thought it was going to be a contest for who had the funniest looking car. like a costume contest, like Mardi Gras parade floats. This comes with... Okay, I will. Thank you, Jess. This comes with a little comment card. Thank you for purchasing the tape. Register your information. Tell us what you think about it. Little envelope. Diamond P Sports. You put the card in here. You can also dox your friends by giving Diamond P Sports their personal information so that the catalogs will be mailed to them against their will. Anyway, let's check it out. It thankfully has been rewound. And this is in a handsome Fuji cassette. Nice and shiny. Very, very heavy. This is undoubtedly SP at least 2 hours of footage here. Let's get into it. Drag Racing 1993. We will do a poll at maybe 20 minutes. We'll see. We'll see how we feel. Are you ready? Ooh, what a dynamic font on this copyright warning. Diamond P. Ooh, hell yeah. I started recording at just the right moment. I wish there was sound, though. Diamond P Sports video presentation.
The 1993 NHRA Winston drag racing season. Championship drag racing at its best. A total of 18 events starting and ending the year on the West Coast. Sandwiched in between 16 of the top races at the best venues drag racing has to offer. A $1 million payout at the end of the year awaits the championship drag racer.
No more Pemmas. This is Drag Racing 1993. We've just started it.
Funny car, pro stock, and
funny car.
Motorcycle. Welcome everyone to Drag Racing 1993.
Some great titles. Would y'all like me to boost the audio slightly?
That carried Eddie Hill to his first ever Winston Championship at the tender age of 57.
3 decibels.
Hi everybody, I'm Dave McClelland, and welcome to Drag 93, an in-depth look at the entire 1993 NHRA Winston Championship season, all 18 events, and joining me as always, my good pal Steve Evans. And Steve-O, it's been quite a year.
You bet. In fact, something for everybody. In pro stock, there's a winner for the scientist, I guess, in some of us. With Eddie Hill, that's a victory for the dreamer in all of us. And in funny car, well, our winner is undoubtedly the most outrageous personality in all of American motorsports. And you talk about
funny car.
Some I didn't expect to see for years. We'll talk about all of them.
Well, there's no need in prolonging this agony any longer. Let's get right to the action. And here we go to Pomona, California.
The agony of talking to Steve.
Who says it doesn't rain in Southern California? After a one-week weather delay, over 30,000 people jammed into the brand-new aluminum grandstands in the all-new stadium-style Pomona Raceway. Dave McClellan, it's a wonder what about $5 million will do to a racetrack. Incredible improvements. We saw a sample of them at the Winston Finals the year before, but it was at the inaugural race of the 1993 season that we saw the defending Winston champion Warren Johnson make his way to his favorite spot on the racetrack. The final round of pro stock.
And his competition, well, this was a dream final for the fans. They got to see Warren Johnson up against the vaunted Dodge, driven by Scott Jeffrion. He didn't have the best...
Ooh, Scott Jeffrion.
...he wanted, but in 93, everyone hoped the Dodge was going to fare well from the young man from Huntington Beach, California.
That young man had finished number two in the Winston points chase the preceding year. Here was his opportunity to instantly grab the lead right at the start of the 93 season. But as so often has happened the year before, not to be. Problems for Scott Jeffrion. A big win for Warren Johnson, 7.24.
All right, those are cars. They're going real fast.
The run wasn't that well. It started missing about half track.
That's what I'm getting so far.
On the engine, but... We got off the starting line, that's all that matters. I think Scott may have had some trouble. I don't think it was that late.
Okay, congratulations. What a way to start a season.
Thank you very much, Steve.
The problem Scott Jeffrion had was a broken line lock.
So in pro stock, the Winston champ scored early in the 93 season. What about in funny car? Cruz Pedregon was the number one qualifier
in the car.
McDonald's Oldsmobile from Larry Minor Motorsports at a 5-10, a blistering lap time, the Pomona pavement. But in round number two, he met up with Dale Foldy, the seldom raced Paisano family car.
Come on, McDonald's funny car.
Rusty. Here he wasn't out on Pedregon. He left with him, but he outran the defending champion.
Mm.
A 5-12 to a 5-20. Cruz Pedregon out second round at the Winter Nationals. Not what that team had hoped for.
As I said it before the beginning of the year, that this funny car season is going to be awesome. You know, these guys are out here running good, and we just got beat today, but we'll be back definitely.
In the championship round, Dale Foldy was nowhere to be.
Yeah, the car looks kind of like skewed too. Like it's driving forward, but it's tilt. The body of it is at an angle. That's how Leica walks down a hallway.
Winston Chase in 1992. This was a mission. He said, "This is comeback tour '93," and he started it off at the Winter Nationals with a final round appearance.
Forrest got a big break in round number one. He was defeated by Whit Bazemore with a 5-11, but Bazemore was disqualified for crossing the center line. So against Worsham, it was John Forrest with Lady Luck along for the ride. Forrest had the whole shot. Worsham.
Funny car.
They beat me ever since Indy, and McDonald's team did, and all the way through Topeka, the breakies, rolling my old hunks upside down, trying to drive. Like, I was starting to think maybe I ought to get out of this business or get into Top Fuel. But today, Wally Parks' birthday. This is a great deal. I brought a new group in, Larry Frazier. I spent more of that Castro money. Jolly Rancher, Owes, Wax Shop, Dorman, Craftsman.
One thing was obvious at Pomona. John Forrest had not...
That guy's on cocaine.
...during the winter layoff.
All drag racers must be.
...forgotten how to race well. The guy that finished second in the Winston Chase in Top Fuel in 1992 came to Pomona and the Chief Auto Parts Winter Nationals and blasted out a run of 4.78 seconds at over 296 miles an hour. That qualified him number one. Let's watch. What a pass by Corey Mack. I had a good time, Dave, with this interview, talking to the man who could have and should have been the champ.
478.
Oh, my God. I don't believe it.
Isn't that fun?
I knew it was good. She carried the wheels. I never thought she was going to set them down. And then on the top end, it started coming around. But I'll tell you, Jimmy Prock, Ted, Billy, the whole crew, they deserve it.
On the very next qualifying pass, Corey Mack backed up the 478 for a new national record. Coming into Pomona at the start of the 93 season, only Kenny Bernstein had run 300 miles an hour. It was still a magic barrier waiting to be broken by the next person, and we did not have to wait long. It was round number one of the Chief Auto Parts Winter Nationals when Doug Herbert in the near lane lined up.
We're at 7 minutes. How long did we make it into the Tour de the Vuelta de España, the bicycle racing tape? I think we made it 10 minutes. And then we were done.
I can't believe we, you know, Verset kept telling me. One of these
this seems very similar, where it's this is exciting if you're a drag racing fan, and if you're not, it's a lot of a lot of drag racing footage.
Thank you.
A big thumbs up from only the second member of the Slick 5300 mile an hour club. There would be more before the season would end. The Top Fuel final round was broadcast live on TNN. Joe Amato versus Kenny Bernstein. Joe Amato, the defending Winston champion, five-time Winston champion. Bernstein appeared to have his number, though, Dave, throughout qualifying and elimination.
Do you know any of these people, or are they like the stories of early 90s drag racing?
Flawlessly all day long.
Or are you just appreciating it for the car?
Driving superbly.
The cargo fast.
Reaction time. The determining factor in so many races is how quick can the driver get off the starting line. Bernstein was definitely on the number. Let's watch what happened.
For me, oh no.
As the engine blew, the tires let go.
Oh no.
Bernstein slammed into the guardrail.
Oh God.
Overturned, but finished upright as the Safety Safari crew rushed to the scene. As millions of people nationwide watched on live television, their hearts were in their throats, wondering what condition was Kenny Bernstein in. As we watched in replay, we saw the engine let go, the tires blew, and Bernstein's Budweiser King slammed into the guardrail. Actually, it went in backwards, and that's probably the determining factor that kept Bernstein from receiving serious injuries. It broke in two right behind the cage. The car vaulted over the rail, turned over one.
Funny car.
Upright.
It's just ejecting hot chunks of metal into the crowd, too.
As the Safety Safari arrived on the scene, Bernstein was conscious.
Like, I know there have been some infamous NASCAR incidents back in the day where, like,
I sure did, Dave, and I had no idea.
Car parts went into a crowd and, like, killed multiple people.
I'm very happy to report that my...
It's not just the drivers that are in danger.
...speaking in foreign tongues.
It's Kenny, you're indeed okay.
I'm okay, Steve. Tell everybody I'm fine. The bell rung a little bit. Kind of feel like a NASCAR Cup car driver here at Atlanta, but not too bad.
See what I mean? What's a NASCAR Cup car? Steve, I think he was remembering the moment that he backed his Winston Cup car, his NASCAR car, into the wall at Atlanta. We rode on board. Watch this. Until the camera signal went away because of the impact with the wall, we had truly Mr. Toad's Wild Ride, but the chassis, the roll cage...
I want to get off Mr. Toad's Wild Ride.
All right, it was time for race number two. Just 2 weeks later, Firebird International Raceway in the glorious desert community of Phoenix, Arizona, the Motorcraft Ford Nationals. Anybody who wondered about Kenny Bernstein's dedication to drag racing after that crash... Well, he was back in a brand new race car, and in round number one, he had no competition because Jack Ostrander couldn't show up. And for Bernstein, it was just as well. A horrible engine explosion and fire certainly would have meant defeat had there been competition. The reigning Winston champ, Joe Amato, had qualified seventh, while Scott Coletta had yet to flex his muscles in the corner.
Why do they make these cars so that they catch on fire and explode?
Top Fuel dragster, the American International Airways car, Amato, of course.
It seems like they shouldn't do that.
Team Valvoline entry. Well, Coletta did everything right here. He leapt on Joe and he whipped him with a 490 at 292 miles an hour to Amato's losing 4.9.
Sombra, are you a person who drives a hearse? Do you own a hearse?
Long, smoky burnout. It sounded as good as it should.
This was round number two racing at Phoenix, and the man he was up against was the driver of the Pennzoil machine, Eddie Hill, out of Wichita Falls, Texas. Eddie, number one.
Hey, seemingly Jess, thank you for the 1,000 bits. Could use some more bells and whistles. Let's do it.
Bernstein certainly was no slouch off the starting line, but he just did not have it mechanically as Eddie Hill went on to take the win with a subpar 490.
Let's see, we're at about 12 minutes on this. I'm going to make a poll.
We moved into the semi-final round, or final four as we like to call it. It was Pat Austin from Tacoma, Washington, his Syntax special, up against Jim Head. Head over the far lane. This time it was Austin's turn.
Poll is up.
Fire, but he stayed on the gas.
Do you want to see more cars exploding?
Wonder it didn't burn the
or do you want to pick another random tape?
Beat him as Jim Head's parachute shook out at half track, and he was having to pull it through. That set up the final. Eddie Hill in the far lane, Pat Austin in the near lane. And you could chalk up win number one of 93 for Eddie Hill.
Well, I'm looks like we are this weekend. I mean, done with car 10 to 5.
Come easy. We had a lot of trouble. And the guys we just barely made the last couple of rounds because we had so many things broke, little things that pick at you.
But ran a 492. Let's walk back to the rear of the car. You're not going to like what you see on the left rear tire.
Maybe 16 runs is too many, huh?
16 runs on a set of tires. After Phoenix, here was the standings in top duel. Amato Hill, Bernstein, McClenathan, and Scott Coletta.
Remember I told you at Pomona how well Whit Bazemore had...
That was Drag Racing 1993 from Diamond P Sports. Thank you to Good Fortune Coffee for sending that one in. And this is courtesy of Seemingly Jess with 1,000 bits. I think we could use some more bells and whistles. Here is more bells and whistles. If you missed Don't Touch Me, you probably also missed this one, which was a real highlight for us from this. This came from Computer Animation Festival Volume 1.0. I wonder if this was all like procedural, like if they scripted this or if it was all hand animated. I assume it would have been mostly procedural. Driven by MIDI or something. But the little flourishes, like the drumsticks flipping around and stuff, that had to be hand done, at least. And whistles. Thank you. That is from Computer Animation Festival Volume 1.0, if you're interested in the tape. It was our previous stream, I believe. All right. Let's pick one more random tape. At least one more. We want only things we have not seen before. Random. Calinetics, 10 years younger in 10 hours. We can save that one for an actual fitness stream. Tybo Live, same thing. Share Fitness. Thank you. We need to get rid of the Focus on the Family tapes. Kid songs. I Can Do It. How do you feel about this? I think I know how Hayley 92 feels about kid songs. How do we feel about a kid songs? Oh my god, it's the Biggles? Okay, so should we watch... Should we watch Boppin' with the Biggles first, since that's the introduction of the Biggles, it seems like? Like, that's the oldest tape we have with the Biggles. Should we do Boppin' with the Biggles? Let's do Boppin' with the Biggles. Yeah. What fresh hell is this? Let's see. I'll go get it. I'll be right back. Kid songs. Boppin' with the Biggles. Starring Billy and Ruby Biggle. Oh, Biggle ghosts. Look at those Biggles. Have I thought of adding another shelf? I don't think I will. I think I'll hold off on that and just use the space I have. Because we got to get through these tapes. I don't want more shelves. Kind. Actually, I think this one was... No, this one wasn't shrink-wrapped, but some of them were. All right, let's see. Kids songs, music, video, stories. Right. The Kids Songs kids have a fabulously fun day when their magical friends, Billy and Ruby Biggle, take them on a musical adventure. They go back in time to a 60s diner and rock it out to Rock Around the Clock and Peppermint Twist. And it's all aboard for the train yard where the kids sing and dance to the Locomotion and Little Red Caboose. Join the Kids Songs kids as they put their dancing shoes on and go bopping with the Biggles. Also featuring Walking the Dog, Head, Shoulders, Knees, Alley Cat, La Bamba, Put Your Foot Right There, and Paw Paw Patch. Head, shoulders, and knees. Just knees. I have nothing below the knees. My legs were shot off in WW2. I have head and shoulders, knees, only knees. Okay, kid songs, bopping with the Biggles. Let's do it.
It's gonna get dark soon.
I guess that was a very Cotton Hill inspired rendition, yeah. Kid songs. A Day at Old MacDonald's Farm, winner of Vera Award.
ViewMaster Video, a leader in children's entertainment. And Warner Brothers Records, a pioneer in the music video industry, present a Together Again video production of Kid Songs.
Boppin' with the Biggles, starring the Kid Songs kids and the Biggles.
So, what do you want to do today?
I don't know.
Hey, look, here she comes.
The same time every day.
My mom says she can set your watch fire.
Now that's what I call a big dog.
Wow. Oh, no. What is happening? Why did they... What? Why did they decide
Merry
that the Biggles were necessary?
Silver buttons up and down her vest.
Howdy, Kiwi. Yeah, the website is properly displaying your name now. I don't know why. I didn't change anything. I bet it's because what I store is just the user ID, and then I look up the usernames from the Twitch API, but I cache that. But if there's a cache miss, it should refetch, but I guess it doesn't. Because all I did was restart. I think I restarted the tape server. Or just enough time passed. Anyway, it's fun technical BS. Walking the dog seems pretty self-explanatory. You get the dog and you walk. The dog kind of walks itself. Most dogs just walk.
Mary, Mary, quite contrary. How does your garden grow?
Silver garden. What? Yeah, I was wondering that because they're not explaining the Biggles at all. None of the children are reacting to the Biggles. No one seems bothered by the Wiggles or surprised that the Wiggles are there.
Hey kids, do you want to go on an adventure?
Yeah!
Billy, what are you up to?
I feel like getting out and seeing the world.
I don't like the mouth.
Dancing.
Puppetry.
So who wants to go bopping with the Biggles?
I do.
Great. Ready?
These creatures are... these creatures are on meth. They are very, very animated and excited.
Now, before we can
just tweaking around all over the place.
We've got to warm up a little.
That's a good idea. How about something easy to get us started? Like head, shoulders, knees, and toes.
Great.
Oh, there are toes.
Justin, let's start shaking it.
La cabeza, la nariz, cabeza, hombros, los pies, los pies.
Feet and tummies, arms and chins, arms and chins.
We sang this song. I had a...
tummies, arms and chins, arms and chins.
I had Spanish class starting from kindergarten. So in kindergarten, we sang this song, but in Spanish. Ojos, orejas, la boca, la nariz, cabeza, hombros, piernas, pies, piernas, pies. Piernas, pies. Ojos, orejas, la boca, la nariz, cabeza, hombros, piernas, pies, piernas, pies.
Head and shoulders, knees and toes, knees and toes.
Oh, Billy, everyone did so well with that. Now let's try a little box step.
How about we get dressed up and zap on over to the continent and trip the light fantastic.
Do what? The continent? The light fantastic?
It's another way of saying, let's go to Europe and do some...
I never thought I would miss Mr. World. Or Uncle George.
Right foot right and left foot left. Right, back, left, back, left. And right knee, left knee, left. Right kick, left kick, clap, and turn.
We go on the prowl each night, like an alley cat. Looking
morning, Argie. We got, we toured Scotland. That was pretty chill.
Like an alley cat.
And then we learned about work. And choosing quality childcare in Oklahoma and drag racing.
Let's clap now, meow. That's what dancing's all about. We move so smooth and get it right. There's no doubt of that. When we dance, we're out of sight, like an alley cat.
I don't like the high pitch shriek timbre of this vocal performance. I don't think the Biggles are helping. Like children singing in unison is already kind of an aggressive auditory experience. And then they throw in pitch shifted, like adults doing nasally voices pitch shifted up. And I don't like it. Unfortunately, there is no pitch shift option in OBS for me to just shift it down.
Billy, dancing is so much fun.
Ruby and I love it. You could say we're the Fred and Ginger of Biggles.
Let me see. Oh, advanced note taking? No, we have not. We have not watched that.
Famous dancers, right? That's right. Speaking of famous dancers, have you kids ever heard of those talented folks from Veracruz, Mexico, who do La Bamba? Well, they do the most fabulous footwork you'll ever see.
Can we go see them?
See. Vámonos, mis amigos. We're going south of the border.
They're just doing Mr. World's shtick, but crappier. Una poca de gracia. Una poca de gracia. Ti seré, por ti seré. Marinero. Yo no soy marinero, soy capitán. Soy capitán, soy capitán. Ba ba bamba. Ba ba bamba. Ba ba bamba. Para bailar la bamba se necesita una poca de gracia. Una poca de gracia pa' mi patita y arriba y arriba.
Y arriba y arriba.
Yeah, there's a lot of very quick cuts. And it's not really timed to the music very well. That guy's just randomly tap dancing. I don't know if they're actually... I guess the kids are singing La Bamba. Why didn't they just bring back Mr. World for this?
That would be simply marvelous, old boy.
Righto.
Hey, I do the accents around here.
Do
Cheerio!
Mr. World was from like 86, 88, something like that. This tape is from 94. They kept doing kid songs for a long time, more than I would have expected.
Put your little foot, put your little foot right there. Walk and walk and walk and walk and turn. Walk and walk and walk and walk and turn. Walk and walk and walk and walk and turn. Walk and walk and walk and walk and turn.
Yeah, this is not very efficient route planning to go from Europe to Mexico, then back, then to the UK.
Put your little hand, put your little hand. Put your little hand right there. Put your little hand, put your little hand, put your little hand right there. Walk and walk and walk and walk and turn.
What the hell is this song anyway?
Walk and walk and walk and turn. Walk and walk and walk and walk and turn. Walk and walk and walk and
I think the quality of the the quality of the music has declined, I think. Like, I don't like 90s kid songs as much. It has a much more, like, shrieking child quality to it. This song in particular is very egregious. We've been to Mexico, we've been to England, now we're gonna go to the 60s. Howdy, Toku. This is our first taste of 90s kid songs featuring the Biggles. Oh, wait, tape. Definitely can only improve this song to have Peter Gabriel on top of it. Nowhere to go but up. I think it's not just the pitch and the timbre, it's also that children, at least the way they're being directed and the kind of music they're singing, children just don't have dynamic range. Like, everything is just screaming. I mean, granted, there's not a lot of, like, mezzo piano in Do the Locomotion. Yeah, having the Biggles in there is not helping. Like, they could have, if they had hired, like, Luciano Pavarotti to sing with the kids, that, I think, could have improved it. The Biggles are not helping. The Biggles are even worse.
Hey, look! There's a little red caboose right over there.
Like, it's really a wonder that the kids' songs we've seen so far have been as watchable as they have been, given that the whole conceit of the tape is kids singing, which is not a thing that most people enjoy listening to. But Biggles singing is even worse than kids singing. So put them both together, and what do you got? But we have to see the Biggles.
My favorite car, 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 traveling so far, 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 far.
It's my favorite car, car, car.
When you go to choo, 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 you look so cute, 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 little red caboose behind
Thank you, Jay Swick, for the 1,000 bits, for the Kirk emotion. Much appreciated. The car status. Oh, I forgot about the car status. How many minutes do you think this tape has been going, everyone? It's approximately 30 minutes long. We're at 17. Chain. And on that track, that the train.
Can you take us anywhere we want to go?
Sure thing.
Can he even take us back in time?
Well, I think so. When and where do you want to go?
To one of those great old diners from the city.
Yeah, Little Red Caboose, I believe, is an official... An original kids song. And I believe it's the worst original kids song we've heard.
What's your pleasure?
Hamburgers and fries.
Me too.
Three hamburgers and three fries.
Oh, good. Child labor.
Want to learn the latest?
The coolest?
The greatest?
Uh-huh.
Pa shupa, pa shupa.
Like this, the peppermint twist.
Pa shupa, pa shupa.
Round and round.
Yeah, the dancing is very objectionable too. I think I'm okay. I'll be all right. We can have a virtual group hug. They hit the bricks. Down where the peppermint twisters meet. Ba-shoo-pa, ba-ba-ba-ba shoo-pa. Learn to do this, the peppermint twist. Ba-shoo-pa, ba-ba-ba-ba shoo-pa. They're just kids.
You know, Ruby, I've always wanted to go to a drive-in.
Yeah, we're almost done with it.
Right this way.
It's only 30 minutes.
3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, Robin. 5, 6, 7 o'clock.
It's well produced and weird.
10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, Robin.
Children singing. Around the clock tonight, we're gonna rock till broad daylight. Rock, gonna rock around the clock tonight.
When the clock strikes 2 and 3 and 4, if the band goes down, will yell for more.
We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. We're gonna rock till broad daylight. Rock around the clock tonight.
Around the clock tonight.
5, 6, 7 o'clock, stand back, rock. Peter Gabriel, Steve, please. All right. It does. The way it works is that it did give you 1,000 golden VCR fun points, and then it took away 300 of those to make Peter Gabriel appear on screen because your message had the word stand back in it. But regardless, we can listen to Peter Gabriel's Steam on the playlist here. Thank you to Jacebook for the 1,000 bits. We're going to do the Kirk emotion and the Steam emotion.
I think I just about danced out.
Me too.
Next up, home.
You bet.
I really love it when you take us on an adventure.
We had fun too.
What are we going to do now?
I know a game.
End of a tape. Roll credits. Let's see. Yeah, I can guarantee this is the last song.
Picking up pawpaws, put them in your pocket. Picking up pawpaws, put them in your pocket. Picking up pawpaws, put them in your pocket. Way down yonder in the pawpaw patch. Where, oh, where is dear little Katie? Where, oh, where is dear little Katie? Where, oh, where is dear little Katie? Way down yonder in the pawpaw patch.
Come on, kids, let's go find her. Come on, kids, let's go find her. Come on, kids, let's go find her. Way down yonder in the pawpaw patch. Picking up pawpaws, put them in your pocket. Picking up pawpaws, put them in your pocket. Picking up pawpaws, put them in your pocket. Way down yonder in the pawpaw patch.
I really, there's so many nasally high-pitched screaming voices. Does this song really need to be this long? What things? The pawpaws or the biggles? Yeah, those are pawpaws. Those are like persimmons.
Ruby, can we stay and play another game?
I think we better get home to Biggles.
I think you better. Go to Biggleland. Get the hell out. Oh, thank you, Swift. Go for it.
The red caboose.
Universal Studios Hollywood. Oh boy. That's very good, Swift. Thank you for making that. I love it. I love it. Oh, yeah. I remember Afro-Cuban drum coordination for drum set being advertised. Is this just footage of Universal? Yeah. Oh, my God. 1994. That was the year the Flintstones movie came out. That was one of the first movies I saw in my life. This has been Kid Songs.
Hi, we hope you love the tape you
A different Kid Songs promo.
We want to take a moment.
Look at that mullet, oh my God.
Kid Songs. The Kid Songs video collection has really great videos.
about all the things that us kids are interested in,
like animals.
Old MacDonald had a farm, E-I-E-I-O. And on his farm he had a pig, E-I-E-I-O. With an oink oink here and an oink oink there.
Here and oink there and oink
everywhere. Old MacDonald had a farm, E-I-E-I-O.
Growing up and seeing the world.
Old Man Rhythm is in my shoes. It's no use sitting and singing the blues.
Okay, well, that was great. I want to be clear. That was an assault on our ears, but thank you. Thank you to Haley92 for sending this in. Glad that you can share the love of kids' songs, and glad that we get to experience the love, the joy of kids' songs. All right, let's do our song geepoos, and then we'll be out of here. Thank you, thank you, thank you to everyone for being here today and for enjoying these tapes with us. And thank you to Jacebook for cheering 1,000 bits for God's Property and Peter Gabriel. True Golden VCR classics. And true classics of their respective rights holders and artists, Kirk Franklin and Peter Gabriel. So, God's Property and Steam. Go.
All right. What you saying now?
All right.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
Come on.
What you saying now?
All right.
What you saying now? All the young people driving down the street in their Jeeps. I want you to pump this up real loud so the neighbor can hear you. So it can be one time for your holy mind. Here we go.
I feel like Penis Castle can be a raid message. If you want something that Steven will absolutely brush off and not engage with whatsoever. With fear in his eyes, he will roll those eyes and then say, I'm not going to ask. There's got to be a more wholesome raid message.
I feel a hand clap coming on. Excuse me.
I didn't do it.
I feel a stomp coming on. Excuse me.
I mean, I kind of did, but it was never my intention. Bobbing your head? Are you praising your holy man? Are you putting your gun down? Are you leaving the club? Are you driving around in your Jeep? think Funny Car is a great raid message. This video of Steam feels a little quiet to me sometimes, and I can't tell if that's because it needs to be boosted a little bit or because I'm just so used to, yeah, that volume. I really want to learn to sing this song by heart, but I can't sing along with the recording because of the sync issue. We love Train Peter Gabriel. George Washington Peter Gabriel. Phallic melting gun skeleton Peter Gabriel. Virgin Mary undresser Peter Gabriel. Sexual harassment Peter Gabriel. Snakes and ladders Peter Gabriel. Horny armchair Peter Gabriel. Novelty Naked Lady Pen Peter Gabriel. Gary's Mod Peter Gabriel. Real classic. God, I really want to make a Pokemon game now where you just collect different Peter Gabriels and battle them. Embryonic Peter Gabriel. Infant Peter Gabriel, toddler Peter Gabriel, small child Peter Gabriel, teenage Peter Gabriel. Regular Peter Gabriel. Hypothetical old man Peter Gabriel who looks nothing like the actual old man Peter Gabriel that we know today. Nude gyrating Peter Gabriel. Wiggly noodle Peter Gabriel being spaghettified into a black hole. Ironing board Peter Gabriel. Marionette Peter Gabriel. Puppeteer Peter Gabriel. Shaking the baby tree Peter Gabriel. Trying traveling inside the microscopic pores of a child and investigating its blood cells to learn about the circulatory system, Peter Gabriel. Discovering the infinite expanse of the cosmos in the molecular structure of blood, Peter Gabriel. All right, that was Peter Gabriel's theme. Oh my God, I've never listened to the studio version of Peter Gabriel's theme. Anyway, folks, thank you for being here. We'll have to do a fan music video to animate the missing verse of Steam. Oh, that would be great. This would be a lot of work. A lot of work to do, so I probably won't ever do it. But I have been thinking about how there really should be multiple train alerts for the hype train. Like when it levels up, you get a different version of it. And I feel like a good one for like the end of the hype train or like just getting up to a really high level would be making an alert where the Peter Gabriel train gets suplexed by Sabin from Final Fantasy VI. That would be really fun. Okay. Now let me tell you something. Well, let me also tell you that our next stream will, I believe, hopefully, probably be a Fitness Friday. Friday morning at 10. And then we should have a normal Saturday stream at 10 a.m. So I will see you there. Yes, also, Mal is on camera solo right now. So I don't want you to penis castle her, all right? She's a lady. Do you understand that, people? She's a lady. Funny car. So, thank you all for being here. We're gonna do a raid. Head on over there and watch Stephen Amell play Moon. That's gonna be great. Thank you for being here. Our raid message is funny car. I do real talk, like try to be responsible about the cross-pollination of memes between the Steven universe and the Golden VCR universe, because I don't want Steven and Mal to be dealing with like constant Peter Gabriel shit or whatever, you know, that's for me to deal with. That's my burden. So thank you all for being here. Thank you for enjoying Fun Neat Car and other tapes, and we'll see you next time. Thank you all, friends. Let's get the raid going.
Stand back.
Stand back, indeed. We getting ready to raid? We're ready to raid. All right. Hasta la vista, everybody.
It's gonna get dark soon.